She's just copying.
Yeah. Thanks, Sam. So,
jump right in?
Yes, okay.
Okay, great. So what we thought we would do in the second half tonight is really focus on three things. And the base document that I'm going to be working from is your draft table of contents. And I understand that this was circulated, but I have some more copies here.
How many pieces of paper there are, we always go for the one you didn't.
The one specific.
Thank you. Did you get my name?
Everyone's got that now? This is the draft table of contents.
Oh, yeah, I got that.
Okay, so what we thought we would do is to,
in order to start
moving us forward, part of the way that we can do that is by working with starting to construct our framework. And so the work that you did in terms of the draft table of contents is an excellent starting place. I believe that Jeff circulated this, and he did ask if there were any comments, if people had any comments on it. Now, this time there had been none received, but we could certainly take a moment now, if as you look at it, there's anything you want to identify. One thing I would say about this is that this is a draft table of contents, and you're going to hear me say this a lot. You know, we'll do something, we'll work on it, and then at the end of it, I'll say, you know what? We're not fixed in stone yet, so there's still an opportunity for things to further evolve. But if everyone feels reasonably comfortable that this is a structure that we can start with as our table of contents, just take a moment and then let's just, is there any glaring missing, or can we depart from this table of contents?
And this is to progress on over the next few weeks.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. So in essence, you know, remember when you're at university or school and you did an essay, right? So the first thing was, what's the table of contents? Because that helps us to be clear about what we're filling in. So this is kind of the overall structure.
Yeah, I think it's a fairly comprehensive work to start.
Okay.
So,
can I send in a memo about, I just wanted the issue of, I thought that the issue of crop loss needed a lot more work on it. So I guess that's just in terms of filling in, fleshing it out.
Okay, which section that's would crop loss fall under?
It's 2.1.1.
Okay, and then where it's the...
Agricultural says primary issue.
Crop loss.
Crop loss.
Okay, so that so, seems being a place where we want to have a robust...
Yeah.
Discussion. Okay, perfect.
Well, there was 2.3 was information gaps. And I think that refers to all of these. So under there, it seemed like economic losses, agriculture should be in there.
Okay, so in addition. Good. Any other thoughts on that? Any other information gaps that people might like to include?
I don't see a discussion of a public opinion survey.
Okay, so perhaps actually a new section that deals with consultation and research. Did we have a section that
consultation? Public perception.
That falls under the evaluation criteria, so that'll be on when we get into evaluating. That was going to be
okay.
But we could have a section. I mean, again, this is a working document, so maybe so that we don't lose that. Kelly,
Karen,
sorry. if we have it as a heading, something around, what could something be that's around public? Is it research? Is it, what is it that you're looking for?
It's a survey on public opinions about deer management.
So if there is a survey done, that would be part of this report?
Right.
Okay.
To do or not to do a public opinion survey.
But that could probably be fleshed out under the public acceptability.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so are
that
you...
That could be just an expansion of that.
Okay. Are you okay with that, Chris?
Yeah.
Okay. I was just sitting here while you were here. Okay. Anything else?
Anybody see?
I'm not sure where the best place for me to stand. But if I stand here, you guys all have to turn around.
Corey's got all the real estate.
Yeah, I'm not surprised the real estate here.
Okay. So if we look at the table of contents, then what we thought would be the most useful place to start our discussion tonight is around the section up at the beginning in the overview or introduction, where we actually look at developing some principles. So you've had two meetings now, you've had a wealth of information, you're starting to, you know, wade in, you've heard a bit from each other, you've had some presentations this evening from some subject experts that, to my mind, felt like those were, again, information pieces that linked to the various options. So and that might be something you want to think about going forward for those options. Are there any other additional information that the group needs? But for now, we're going to kind of pull back, right, kind of pull up, and say, what kind of principles do you feel should guide this strategy? And to give you an example of a principle, and I'm not saying this is one that this group would adopt, but just so you, as an example. A principle might be that prevention is achieved through proactive efforts, right? So a principle or a guideline is something conceptual. So I'd like each of you to think about for yourselves, what do you think are some principles that you would like to see incorporated in the strategy? And I want you to just take a moment and put your thoughts, write them onto a notepad. If you can do it as a phrase, try to make it as complete of a phrase as you can. And these are the principles that you think are important to once you've got some done, what we're going to do is we're just going to put them on to the
So this is the idea of the heterogeneity of the issue and of the audiences.
But isn't that the same as problem three?
Three is to do with the importance for it to be something the public will buy into. This is recognition of the complexity. This one is it's not one size solution for all.
Okay.
So again,
it's the collective.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the collective.
Because one says the complexity and the other says not a one.
Okay, so then this actually maybe should be here. Principle, minimize human wildlife conflict to the profit, to the benefit of both. Be open and flexible to new ideas as to how to accomplish this. So minimize human wildlife conflict for the benefit of both. Is that?
That's a specific, I would say, category of its own.
Sounds like a new one.
Yeah,
see that. Practical, cost-effective, and publicly defensible.
That to me is the collective again, the picture.
The idea.
I don't know, we'll get some new thoughts here. Practical, cost-effective. Publicly defensible, is that the same thing as public buy-in?
Necessarily.
Not necessarily?
It could go either direction, I think, without me.
Okay. Well, let's keep it on its own for now because we're not trying to get them all in one. We're trying to get some streams. Must be seen to be respectful. Human viewpoint and environment. This is the first one we've had with an environment.
What was the fourth column?
Here?
sorry. Fifth column.
The new one here?
No, up on the right, sorry there.
This one?
Yep. Fifth column, right side.
This one here?
Didn't you just put something there about...
minimize human wildlife conflict to the benefit of both. Be open and flexible to new ideas.
And what's that one, I guess?
Respectful to human viewpoints and the environment.
Isn't that sort of the same, similar to human wildlife, human environment?
But if you can, we're going to try to squeeze them. So if it doesn't fit, let's leave it separate for the minute. All options identified and explored. Does that mean the recognition of the complexity? Importance of giving impression to a wide range of options?
Sounds like a process of decision. Can you read it again?
Recognition of the complexity of the issue and the importance of giving expression to a wide range of options in the CRD, and this is that all options are identified and explored. So this is around sort of the breadth of options. Now, respect the hunting rights of First Nations and long-term access to deer as a traditional food source. So this is kind of a segment issue. Right? First Nations as a group, is First Nations as a group, do you think of that in the same way we think of agriculture as a group?
No, they're their own. First Nations can be very specific.
But the principle, what's the principle?
Respect for their opinion.
This is going now more, I think, into actual types of users.
Yeah. So it could go in the first column because it's like you have to look at everyone's point of view.
User type.
Yeah.
Okay. No? You're observing, but you're not sharing.
I think that's apples and oranges a bit.
Yeah. Okay.
I think they're different, completely different issues.
Then if that's a big enough one, let's move it over. Group decision is best. That's here in this same. Yeah?
Yes.
Consensus.
importance of public opinion and understanding what causes the conflicts and how to minimize them. So, is this the complexity issue, or is this the gaining public opinion? It's in the same stream, isn't it?
Public check.
Concern for the long-term food security of Southern Vancouver Island as a principle.
Sustainability, maybe.
The benefit of the community and wildlife.
That's part of the first
amendment. The one farming rural.
But food security, who's the beneficiary here? It's rural. Who's the beneficiary of long-term food security?
Community.
So maybe here.
That's almost a bridge.
Yeah.
Interesting. A link. Open-minded on all views and concerns.
It's column three again.
It's five. New ideas.
Open to new ideas, yeah. As a principle, the need for solid research and data to establish baselines for issues and potential solutions. So this comes about, what does data give you? Have anything here that's sort of foundational about our decisions?
Probably the publicly defensible principle.
The complexities of the issue need information to.
Okay, so, and as a principle, would you want the information to be defensible, or would you want the information in order to understand the complexity?
Both, yeah.
Both? Okay, so let's give it the second one. Okay. Now, this must be seem to be respectful, human viewpoint and environment. Did we not get one that seemed to? Maybe they should come up, look at them closer, because
is that the consensus issue? Respect.
These seem to be respectful of the human viewpoint and the environment. So as a principle, we want our strategy to be seen to be respectful of both the human viewpoints. So human viewpoints might be got some here, right? These are viewpoints of one group.
How is that different than being long-term sustainable, respectful of the human environment?
Is being respectful of the human environment equate to sustainable for the group? What does it mean to be respectful?
Sustainable for who? I think it goes into the public buying into it. Myself, it's just the must be seen to be respectful.
Okay, so these are kind of it's good. So these are sort of process being sure that we're thinking thoughtfully about all of those aspects.
voted on all views and concerns?
I don't see that. I don't see that as open-minded. I see that very closed.
Okay.
Opinion.
Okay. So the principle here, let's maybe try to restate this. So the principle is to understand the impacts of the decisions, right? I mean, that's when I read this. This is saying that we shouldn't allow that we need to think about the end point and not be overwhelmed by the emotion around, and this, I presume, relates specifically to one of the options, which would be a lethal reduction. So it's just that we're going to be, maybe this comes almost back into the data point. The need for data, right? That we're taking more of a fact-based, as a principle, we're trying to take a fact-based as opposed to an emotional-based or a balanced, trying to have a balance.
Can you read it again?
Well, because it doesn't really say, and the principle's kind of underneath, so you have to kind of go underneath to get into the principle. In our death-denying culture, we need to move beyond Disney's Bambi thinking. After all, lots of us eat hamburgers from cows and sheep. So the principle under that really just says we need to consider an option, we need to look at the options without being distorted by emotion, so that we want the strategy, the principles to be reasoned and measured and thoughtful, not emotionally driven.
That could almost fit into the facts and scientific data and things, but it depends how you look at it.
Yeah. What do you guys hear? To me, that's, I'm kind of hearing it's like, don't get pulled by the emotion. We want to be balanced. We want to be...
I read it's a little more simple than that. Would just keep all options on the table.
Keep all options on the table. Can I add that?
Well, go ahead.
I think that's...
all options identified.
We're gonna keep the options identified and explore, but I think there's another thought here, which has to do with not being overwhelmed by emotion, but being led by reason. Is that a principle that you want to have a measured, reasonable approach?
Well, no preconceived ideas. I mean, I'm not sure that's what the person is getting.
No, in reference to Bambi, I would think.
Right. So I mean, we have to restate as principles, right? And this is a little bit difficult to do. So I'm trying to find an underlying principle here, which is that we can't be emotional. We need to be taking measured, thoughtful review of the options. And we've got keeping the options. So this, to me, feels like there's more there. Now, if the person who contributed this wants to comment, I'd be happy to make sure we're interpreting this correctly.
That's ironic, because I find that the most emotional response out there. I find that very ironic.
Okay.
Yeah.
So to be measured. And that would be part of this column here, right? Because it's all part of this, of looking at options. I need you to stand up and I need you to come over and look at them. because we need to see if we can find some streams there. Like when you look at those groups of thoughts, what is the, is there an overarching heading? Do I move to the table? Would that be more comfortable? No, you can get that. Why don't you all come up and have a, have a look? And it's just like one, just looking for like one word for sort of the comments.
So what's the unifying element between the things on the notes?
Between the two
pieces we have there.
Farmers need to be understood.
Okay, so needs, is it needs of farmers?
Capture these sort of big ones. Alright, so need, one sort of category then is need, what is it, need for?
Sustainable agriculture.
Okay. How about the second column?
Also to do with sustainability, the public program, the balance.
Okay, but the sustainable in this one, long-term sustainable, so that it's ongoing, benefiting community and wildlife, contributes to a healthy community, and concern for the long-term security of food security of the southern Metro ground. What's the link there?
Long-term sustainability.
Long-term sustainability of what? Of the solution?
Yes.
So long term sustainability of solution. Is there maybe a second thread in there?
I would say the solution has to be compatible for both agriculture and wildlife and all other groups.
So we want to have.
Because the issue, the reason we're all here is human deer conflict. The long-term sustainability has to address the needs of both of those.
And I think actually this one belongs in that column.
So some kind of a benefiting, it's a benefiting principle?
Minimize human.
Well, it's mutually sustainable.
Okay, we're not, we don't have everything all in the same place.
I saw the second one under the long-term sustainability. I just, if we're looking at a decision like he was talking about in his presentation about contraceptives, if it's going to, he's saying it doesn't make sense to vaccinate to, what do you say, 30% or something, because it's just gonna, it's gonna fail in the second year. So whatever solution we have to consider that the long-term effects of whatever that decision is. So that was where I see that.
So this is that it has to be, the principle is that the solutions need to be something that will be enduring over time,
it
not a one shot.
It has to be a practical long-term solution.
Yeah.
So practical long-term, if I add that. Now we have a principle that is clear. that it's about something that is going to be over time. We've added the word practical, which you picked up. Long-term sustainable, definitely.
You could say practical, you could say feasible, you could say
workable.
Yeah.
Okay. What about this idea about benefit? We were talking about something benefiting the community, benefiting wildlife. Is that strong enough to stand by itself as a principle?
It seems to me that if the principle is benefiting wildlife, then we're taking options off the table. Any option that we see is not beneficial to wildlife, no matter how beneficial it is. The others is off the table in that definition, not that principle. Any different principle should take options off the table. Sorry, I think if we say benefiting wildlife as a principle that we must meet all the time, then we're in effect taking options off the table. Because at least some of the options that are at least in theory on the table can't necessarily be seen as beneficial. So if you say they must be beneficial, then
it excludes a whole bunch of
options. Yeah.
Okay.
And you can turn that around and say that benefits people only.
So maybe we want to go back to something else I heard someone say, which was around the minimizing the human deer conflict.
Yeah.
Is that a better?
That's the fifth column.
Yeah. So minimize. This one had a lot of elements in it. Why don't you come back up and have another look at that one, see what rules you can get out of that set of thoughts. So serious consideration given.
Options and solutions.
Consideration of options and solutions based on? Is that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
On all options, isn't that the idea? All options need to be looked at.
Yeah.
And not just some of them.
So all? Anything else that anyone else extracted from these? There was this matter of public education and public opinion. Is there a principle we can extract from that about
sub.
Inclusion,
it, supporting it.
Inclusion of a broader perspective.
I think it sort of refers to, if you want people to accept this, these recommendations, you have to have all the facts, or present a lot of facts so that...
Okay, but remember, or as I understand, what you guys are doing is you're developing a set of, you're developing a strategy that has recommendations in it. Ultimately, it will be the board that will have to make the decision that they're going to advance or not, and with which portions. So these principles are around how you are going to develop your strategy. So is there a principle relative to the opinion or the education or the involvement of the general public that you think is important? Okay, Carrie, can you hold on your thought just for 1 second? Because I just want to have a few other people who I think need a little more time to process. So, thoughts on what kind of piece might you like to see? A principle relative to the public.
I think that our principles have to be in line that the board can accept. Why would we have a principle that 9 principles out of 10 that wouldn't be accepted?
Okay.
So I'm keeping in mind that whatever we put forward is something that could possibly be accepted.
Okay.
So it
needs to be aligned with general public and...
At the same time, I want to make sure that there's a solution to the problem without somebody said they're Bambi.
Right.
I mean, I might think of them, other than Bambi, I might think of them as I think of a robot. Who knows? It's like, you know, people might complain about people's dogs and call the pound to deal with it. I'm not dealing with it. So I think this committee, can do a recommendation, but it's not up to us to implement them. Somebody else is going to implement them.
Okay, but I thought I heard you say something there that had to do with it being something that was implementable.
That's right.
So it must be something that can be implemented.
Yes.
Is that
a new principle, though? Is that, that doesn't come under number 5?
No. It's weird. I think what we're seeing here is there's a couple of, this is a good vein or mind here.
Oh.
It's bringing up some other points. So I would put this as a new 6.
But it has to be.
The strategy must be implementable.
We must feel that the CRD will accept our proposals.
Is it possible that we need to, that it could be saying we may come up with decisions that will not please everyone?
I think that's entirely possible. But just continuing here, what I was hearing was a different point, and I see it here in a couple of them, which is around this issue of public opinion and about something being feasible or...
I see that as tying into the thing that's there, practical, cost-effective.
Oh, that was this one.
Like, for example, if we came up with a $1 billion solution, we're kind of wasting our time, right? So we'd need to come up with something that we believe at least is possible within the realm of possibility.
Within the realm of possibility?
Well, anything's within the realm of possibility.
Money.
I think we have a lot of
money.
Okay.
It has to be publicly credible.
Publicly credible.
Oh.
Okay.
The CRD board represents the CRD, and I think the concern is that people of the CRD are considered their opinions in these solutions. If something is recommended that is totally against public opinion, it's going to be pointless. There's going to be mass public
protest or some kind of opposition. So it's got to be something that includes the general consensus of the people of the CRD.
How do they refine what that is? I don't think there is a general consensus in the CRD on anything.
I agree.
That's right. But we live in a democracy.
Okay. But how about if we...
But nobody votes for the CRD. None of the people in this room, other than me, votes directly for a CRD representative, rather than a electoral representative. You vote for a municipal council, and a municipal councilor, and the mayor of the CRD, you know, directly elected, other than in the electoral area.
But,
is it
just
the minutes
correcting a little bit
their
percentage, and
before
they do
direct elections? Well, no, they don't. Technically, they don't. They put it on the ballot, yeah, and you vote for it, but there's no obligation on the mayor to appoint. In practice, both do.
Yes.
Yeah. But the point is still, they're not elected by the CRD. They're not elected by the mass of people. They're elected in Saanich. And they represent Saanich on the CRD. They represent me. They don't represent Victoria.
Okay. So as from that standpoint, then, as the citizens' advisory group, is it an important principle that what you can bring forward is publicly credible and reasonably reflected?
Well, I think we can do that because we're supposed to be a reflection of the community at large. Yeah. Okay.
So then
the issue at the end of the day is whether they have the money to go out if they want to and do a public opinion survey. Maybe our recommendation might be, yes, you should do that. Or no, we don't think you need to do that because we around this table represent all of those interests.
Right. And I think when you start to see the how these weave together, right? By agreeing and adopting a principle that serious consideration will be given to all viewpoints, that the consideration of all the options and solutions will be based in research and information. And if you look for something that's publicly credible and reasonably reflective, in essence, you are saying that you are undertaking that process as this citizen's advisor.
So I guess I'm confused.
Mm-hmm.
I think that principle number six is okay, but that's what's going to happen. We're not going to come up with anything that's crazy.
Okay, well, good. Then that would be an easy principle to follow.
not by consensus.
Wonderful.
I mean, you know, there may be differences of opinion, but...
it all goes back to the problem we have, where we're all here. Some decisions or whatever may not be popular, but it's like, you know, diverting the water out of your basement. You got to do it sometimes.
And it is the politicians who have to make that decision on us. What is publicly credible? Mm-hmm. I don't think we should get caught up in, oh my God, that might not be publicly credible. We better not say it.
Okay.
Let's not go into that argument.
Okay. Do we just want to be reasonably reflective then?
Yes.
Is public credible too far? What does the rest of you feel like?
Consider all options reasonably reflective. Look at all the opinions, look at all the evidence, get all the experts.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I think it has to be credible and acceptable, you know, to be accepted. So I think whatever we come up with, has to be what does credible mean? It just means it can be done.
Mm-hmm. I guess I see
So we had 10 professional opinions that were not publicly acceptable. Does that mean we don't use any of them?
But hark back to the fact that we are the public, right? The microcosm of the public. So if they're acceptable to us, they should be theoretically acceptable to the public at large, right? Maybe.
I mean, but that's what you're trying to do, right? You are going through this tremendous process of all this information gathering and review and discussion on behalf of what's the total population here. Yeah.
This is the public.
Yeah. So you're, I mean, you guys, you are the proxy.
Basically, if it makes it past us, it's probably fairly credible. I've talked to all of you, and I'm willing to trust the people in this room to filter out things that are totally off the wall. But honestly, I doubt whether anyone's a specialist in wildlife management or communications or law or anything like that would be suggesting things that are so completely bizarre that we couldn't get our heads around them.
Alright, so we'll that's implicit, but we want to keep the reflexive component.
Yeah.
Alright. How about then we've got the consensus. That's obviously a strong one. And that's actually in the terms of reference.
If possible. Terms of reference say if possible.
Okay, so as a principle, do you want to have the weasel words in there, or do you want to go right for the...
Well, I think we
definitely
as much get a consensus, but we don't have to. It's not a requirement.
No, but would you like it to be a principle of your strategy?
I think our principle should be consensus.
No, I mean,
knowing you do have room.
More your mind should be expressed. That may lead.
So all viewpoints expressed, but at the end of the day, consensus means people, whether they may personally agree or not agree, agree that they're prepared to allow the decision to proceed, and they will not undermine it once the decision is come to.
Consensus doesn't mean totally means the decision to be honored.
Yes.
So restated that way, then consensus-based is acceptable as a principle. It doesn't say total agreement. That's not the principle, right?
Maybe we need to say we want to come up with a decision that we can all agree with.
But that runs back to basically 100% agreement, because if one person can't make a decision, then the whole thing goes under the board regardless of how strong. But if you have a majority,
well, the terms of reference indicate that there can be a minority opinion, and that it does, if we can get a consensus, we will. But if we can't, it's majority rules.
Yeah.
But there can be a minority expression of it, of what a minority might, or what anybody who doesn't agree might think, that can be included in the report.
So the strategy, the principle is that consensus is optimal.
Yes.
But you are prepared to table diverging views.
I think that's just following the terms of reference.
Okay.
It is
okay.
Yes.
That's what the terms of reference say.
All right. What about the first? Principle around first.
First Nations to have deer as a food source, we need to make sure that we're managing a continuing population.
Okay.
Because if we're, we can't just get rid of all deer, it's on the ground.
Can we find something that's more along the line of what we have here, need for sustainable agriculture? Is there something, a principle that relates to First Nations more in that regard?
I have a suggestion for dealing with First Nations issues. First of all, Canada Constitution Act 352 says that the Aboriginal treaty rights, the Aboriginal peoples of Canada are hereby recognized and confirmed. We don't have an option, that's in the Constitution. I think what we can do at this table is say that we recognize, appreciate, and respect the cultural aspects of the Aboriginal inhabitants in this area.
Okay, so recognize and respect.
Cultural. I didn't catch the last of it.
Cultural interests.
Cultural interests. How's that? Okay. All right.
And we'll try to tighten these up today, right? We're going to spend all the words that we're trying to get into the big files. And then practical cost effect. This whole concept of, did we already get that?
Practical long term.
Does that need to have a cost component to it as well?
Well,
or is it separate?
Well, practical.
It is a practical
cost.
Okay. this implies cost as well. All right. So need for sustainable agriculture, that the strategy is something that is sustainable over the long term, practical, that includes practicality from a cost standpoint. All of the work in minimizing human-deer conflict, serious consideration to all viewpoints, consideration of all options and solutions based on research and information.
Is it 4 and 5?
Well, viewpoints is of a group or person. These options, I think, relate to what I see in your preference.
How about the first one? There's something bigger there, and that's food security. Food security, to me, is bigger than sustainable agriculture.
Our food security and the business of agriculture, the same thing?
We have them together, the need for food security and sustainable agriculture.
Are they, food security is, I mean, when I look at all the things I've seen and the discussions that I've heard so far, there are issues around the impact of deer human conflict, which is commercial loss. Is that the same issue as food security, which may not involve?
Food security to me actually encompasses
local food security.
This, the issue that we're talking about with First Nations, that their food security is also reliant on this solution. So it's like the bigger picture. We're not just talking
about
the livelihood of farmers, because we could say, okay, let's just compensate the farmers each year that they have all these losses, but at the same time we're reducing the overall food production on the islands by doing that, which decreases our food security.
Food
I mean, we could
security.
Keep feeding in money from all over the province, for example.
Just having enough to eat.
Yeah. So, like, the big thing that I'm hearing all the time in food security discussions is, what if we got cut off from the mainland? We would only have enough food on the lower island for 2 days. So if we're talking about sustaining farmers' livelihoods by every time they have a loss bringing in money from off the island, that doesn't help us deal with the food security of what if we got
there, to me, that's, I don't know if it makes
okay.
sense.
But is food security, as you're describing it, is that an outcome of the deer-human conflict?
Local food security.
Yeah.
And it's not only sustainability of food, but sustainability of food safety.
I'm a single parent in the city and I'm reliant on my garden for food and a deer comes in and eats all my food, I'm not a farmer, I'm not going to get a subsidy for that, but my food security has just gone out the window and now what? So food security is to me it's different from farmers' livelihoods.
Okay, so consideration for impacts on local food security.
Is there anything that's missing here? when you see it framed in that way.
Oh, just a quick point on that. I don't think it has to be versus. I think the two of them can work together to provide a much better...
Oh, absolutely. You know, it's not versus at all, but I think it often helps to organize your thinking or steps by creating some categories of how.
So are we looking at these as like guiding ideas versus that we apply our solutions to versus a mold that they have to fit in or a die that they have to fit through when they're passed on to the other stage?
I think what we're trying to do here is to have some principles so that as we move into discussion of options, right, it gives you another place to kind of touch to, right? So that if we're on a particular option and we agree as a process principle that serious consideration will be given to all viewpoints or all options and solutions.
I guess what I'm getting at is, does each idea have to fit every one of those before it moves on? Or does it just have to be, so is it just a guide that we try and get others to look at versus if that tag doesn't fit through that round hole and start building?
I would suggest that your process pieces, you probably want to, if you felt you couldn't, I mean, by doing this, there's implicit agreement amongst the group that you're agreeing that these are principles that you will be, you will use as your guideline. So in essence, you're making a commitment or you're making an agreement that as you sit here, you're going to be aware of these principles, and you're going to be thinking about those as you evaluate and review the various options.
So does that mean as we come up with certain ideas, then we just have a little checklist? Does it
Are we blatantly contravening our principles by going down this particular path?
So in other words, if there was an option that was practical, cost-effective, but wasn't long-term sustainable, but worked short-term, then you'd consider it as an option.
The strategy, right? These are principles for the strategy. And I think, from what I've seen, from what they're working with, that it probably isn't a... There's not a one-shot solution, there's a one-time solution. There's going to be some kind of a blended plan. The principle here, I think, was that the strategy would be something that could go forward over time. It's not something that either is so expensive or so, I can't imagine what, it's impossible to sustain.
I'm not sure about that. I understand that as a principle, but that's different from saying take each option and judge it against the principle. Because if long-term sustainability and long-term impact is a principle, then there are a whole host of options that are on the table.
Okay, fair. So what we're saying is that these are the principles that form the strategy.
And then there would be evaluation criteria if you would rate each option.
So some would strongly agree with the strategy and some are a bit...
Right, that's the piece that we're going to do. The next piece that we have is the actual evaluation criteria for the options.
I think I understand. But I have still have a concern that it is skewing certain things. If the basement is flooded, we have a lot of long-term options, but you have one very important short-term option. Drain it, get the water in. Putting a pump in and pumping water out is not a sustainable, practical, long-term solution. But you have to do it in order to
And
go
you have
right.
to dig up your drain pipes to Europe.
Yeah,
so that's part of that long-term strategy.
Yeah, exactly. In and of itself is a piece.
Right.
It's not long-term and it's not sustainable. Okay. But you've got to do it to deal with the immediate problem, which is basically the water.
That's why we test the strategy against all these, not every single
thing.
It's a good
stop it, but we probably have to explain why you would think that it would, there could be a problem down the road if you went with this, and that may be totally open as far as what we knew. And to agree with reality, I mean, if we said, well, this will work, but we don't say, but you'll have to do it again next year, then that would be like an interest only block, and they find out afterwards.
Right. So the strategy itself, you're looking for something that is going to give you long term, some type of long term return, but there may well be. What's the word you have for? There may well be options. Some options may be short term. So is everybody clear on that? Should we note that there may be short term options? Do you want that written here?
As long as everybody's clear on it.
Well, let's just capture it. So it does not preclude. Does not preclude use of short term options. Does not preclude use of short-term options. Alright?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's leave these. And
excuse me.
Yep.
I find there's something missing.
Okay.
In all the experts' reports and of course the government correspondence, it talks about the fact that wildlife it's here to stay. So I would think consideration for wildlife should be on there as well. If we're talking about things like consideration for food security, I would think wildlife should be on there as well. Because they're here and they're here to stay, and that's what all the experts are saying, that they're here. So we're going to have to deal with them in some way or another. So the fact is they're here, and that's why we're all here.
Yeah, I don't think anybody was talking about the eradication of deer with the CRD.
No, but that needs to be acknowledged.
Okay, well we start with this.
There's minimize the human deer conflict.
Can we add to
it's the deer management strategy. So how can we, any ideas people have for Carrie, how can we, is there a way we can incorporate in our principles something around this? Is this a place where we can
there's something I'm not, and there's also respect for like humane treatment of deer too. Like that seems to be
can play with this a little bit and get it back to you, and maybe what we can do is put one umbrella principle around sustainability in a sense of industry sense as opposed to over time. And because I think there's a few of them, like the food security, the First Nations that really call out that broader umbrella of sustainability and including considerations for wildlife and ecology.
So you're saying put wildlife under sustainability?
Was that, do you play with
that?
That's
fine.
That
yeah, it's fine, but I think they need to be acknowledged. It needs to be acknowledged.
Go down that rabbit hole right now, but that is the point about sustainability, right? But again, I think one of the things that's always a challenge in any approach like this, any project, is to stay in your scope, right? Because there's lots of other issues out there to be addressed, and you can only do, we only do what we can with that kind of time. Okay, good. That was good. This is hard to do. Hard to think about these things, but that's a great start. So the next thing we wanted to look at were the goals and objectives. And it's my understanding that the overarching goal of this strategy, and it's right from the terms of reference, is to address the deer-human conflicts
Coalition. And particularly agricultural impacts is first. And then in equal measure, public health and safety and urban and residential vegetation. So the good news is the goal has already been defined, right? It's very clear in terms of reference for the strategy and very clear in terms of reference for this working group. But the objectives of the strategy, what do you see that those should be? And one thing that, when we talk about an objective, an objective is something that's very specific, right? So if I was to give an example, an objective might be to identify three distinct geographies. If we look across the literature, there's lots of discussion about these different issues, the fact that we do have different considerations for agricultural, rural, and urban. So might an objective be to identify strategies for three distinct geographies? I'm just giving you that as a, just to get
it. I think the first objective should be to measure the agricultural impact.
That's the goal of the strategy?
Well, we can't do one without the other. We can't decide on what the strategy relating to agricultural impacts should be unless we know what the agricultural impacts in fact are.
Okay, but if given the reality of your situation, I think you might be able to have an objective, which is to establish a monitoring method for the strategy going forward. But I don't think you're going to have all that data before you need to finish developing your strategy.
Well, I think we have some data already, and I just think we need to make it better.
Okay, well, what if you have all the data that, if you have all the data that you have, there's no other data coming?
What I'm saying is, at least from my perspective, reading what I've seen in terms of what we have, it's not good enough.
Okay, but that becomes then, Robin, that becomes a input that you need before you can fully respond to the options.
Sure.
Absolutely, and that is, if I understood it, that's partly what we had today, was two subject experts who were providing additional information that you're using as inputs to your decision-making on the options. But as an objective for the strategy, is there a measurement objective going forward?
Well, I guess the measurement, the objective would be to lower the human agricultural conflict. The objective is to have deer eat less food that the farmers are growing. That's the object.
Okay. Do you want to put a number on that?
Well, I can't. No, I can't.
No, no. But do you want to lower the impact by 5%?
Well, I don't know, because I don't know what the impact is. Mm-hmm. That's the issue.
But
5% of what? I mean, I need to know what in order to say 5, 10, 15, 20%.
Okay. So if in the absence of that data, can we, what I'm hearing you say though, is that you would like to have some kind of an objective which speaks to tangible measured outcomes.
Is the objective on this to improve one objective of the strategy is to recommend take steps to improve the level of information?
Yes. I mean,
because the
to me, seems like that could be a very positive recommendation, right? There's something tangible there. It's an outcome of what you're looking at as you go through. But I think the point that we're hearing here is we can't stop this process. We have to deal with the data we have now. But this to have something going forward.
No, I agree with that. But I guess, you know, what we have now is, and I have no, I'm not quarreling with the data. I have absolutely no idea how accurate it is. But we have information from, what, 20 farmers? 29 farmers, is it Ghana?
29.
Okay. So I have no idea what that represents. Is that a third of the farmers on the CRD? Is it all of them?
Right.
So it doesn't, you know, and we have lost numbers. We have, you know, farmers saying, yes, we lost $25,000 last year. Okay, that's, but there's no context.
Okay.
If you're making $1 million and if you lost 25,000, it's not very much. But if you only make 50,000 and you lost 25,000, then you're losing 50% of your business. And I don't see how we can construct something unless we have that kind of context.
Okay, but in terms of, within the absence of all of that hard data, which I think everyone hears, we would all always, and in fact every decision, we always like to have more information. But we had a suggestion that an overall objective is to decrease the number. I think wasn't that the point that we were hearing from Orlando about or Vince? But it's the metric, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So could we answer?
Was we also have data from car collisions,
yes.
People to human,
yeah.
You know, so, and I think there may be a bit more, not that it's going to be possibly give us any firm numbers, but you may be able to get a certain amount of news footage from the local TV station, newspaper, that may help a little bit on, you know, getting a grasp of maybe what's being lost without putting the dollar figure, we don't, you know, some farmers may feel that they lost, in one field they could have lost $7,000, and the next farmer in the exact same field could say, well, my figure's $10,000, you know. So you actually weigh it, you know, all that kind of data is...
Well, and I think, I think you guys understand too that although there have been other jurisdictions dealing with this, there's some things that are unique, as I understand it, about your situation here because of the agricultural, rural, urban, and the fact that it's happening in 2012, right? Our whole social, cultural conference is different. So there's also, I think, there's a role here for you in terms of precedent. And so while you might wish that you could have something stronger here, the fact that you can improve this as a precedent going forward is going to also inform other people's strategies. So, you know, I think that's a very, admirable objective and would be a tremendous outcome of this plan. Just got Mark and then
I just wanted to point out that when Orlando was making his presentation this afternoon, they didn't have any specific numbers on agricultural impact. He did have numbers on the amount of grant that was given to farmers to help mitigate wildlife impacts. And you know, so clearly province and the environmental farm plan, we're able to come up with a program to help assist farmers dealing with wildlife without having the the loss, the economic loss data in the entire region. Your recommendation may be formulated around the farmer having to submit some of that information to qualify for assistance if you are looking at a recommendation that involves a stewardship program, for example. So there may be other ways to come about it as opposed to trying to gather information beyond what we currently have.
And I just wanted to go back to the presentation today on the trend that your population is going up rapidly, not down at all. So decisions made in the next 1 or 2 years or whatever might be, advantageous in the future when it comes to, if they're talking about who knows how many years in the area, whether there's 500 or 5,000, mm-hmm. what happens if that falls tenfold?
Right. So again, improving the level, that's good, and then decreasing the incidence. Then you want to try and say by what? You want to decrease the incidence of deer human loss? Do you want to? What do you want to do? How do you want to describe that?
I just picked up on what Rob was saying earlier about the measurements. When picking out indicators that we would like to have data on for future decision makers be a specific goal, because we said we really need to have stats on economic losses in the CRD per year, and that might give the CRD some incentive to actually collect information that may not be widely available or compiled at the state. And that's pretty specific, and from a social science perspective, getting the data like that is really crucial for monitoring and for checking whether the measures are working, but also for giving people in the future some idea about what they need to do in order to actually address some of these things.
Okay, so maybe I should pull that in somehow and identify what those indicators may be as an outcome of the work that you're doing on the strategies. What about decreasing the incidence of deer human losses, deer human? How, what is it?
The conflict.
Okay, but you said the goal is to address your human conflicts. What is it that you want to actually decrease the incidence of?
How would you measure it?
Sorry?
How would you measure it? That's what you're asking. As measured by, so you're decreasing, there's your vector, you're going to decrease something. It's measured by.
Actually, no one. You might be able to do it if you're far out and that kind of thing, but I mean, again, you don't have a base measure.
But
okay.
You mean,
but
if we go up one level,
would it be possible to say decrease the incidence of deer human conflict and then be a little bit more specific?
Yeah,
in agricultural. Problems or
interactions, except as we've already addressed this. All right. What else are you trying to do? Do you want to put, and I understand the regulations, but do you want to put something here that has any kind of time basis on it? So do you want to decrease the incidence of deer human conflicts in agricultural rural or urban settings within the next 24 months?
I think we have to do that, though. Otherwise, we're going to be sitting here 5 years going, we need more data, we need more of this, we need more of that. We can't make any kind of poor decision because we don't have enough of proper data.
Well, we don't want to get analysis paralysis either,
no.
Because we are here because the issue has been identified that there is a problem.
Yeah, this objective doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get this before you're done. This is that you want this table, you want this started. It's important as going forward in the strategy, right? So this does not mean we don't start, strategy doesn't start this.
No, that's going to fall into the short-term and long-term solutions, I think, or possible solutions. There's going to be, there could be a number of short-term recommendations for each one, and there could be a number of long-term recommendations for each one.
Okay, how would you feel about this? So reduction in both the short term and longer term. Is that? We've got an overarching goal. We're going to address them, but specifically two objectives. Okay. All right. Well, we are actually at 8:00. So we should close here.
Yeah,
so we're gonna end here, and thank you guys. this work is difficult, it's hard to think about, right? But so what the team will do is pick these away, you know, tighten them up, circulate, and then when we start next week, the first thing we'll do is going to be the evaluation criteria.
Right.
Thanks,
Dan. We have just a few more items before we go. It's going to be a little bit late, so nobody has a problem giving us over time. The next steps and outstanding items, they had talked of having a new business sector section in on the agenda, and this is kind of another way of saying it. Somebody has one of the and the idea behind this next steps, outstanding items, is to bring anything that has come up from previous meetings to be addressed in this section. Tonight, because we've done this other work, which I think has been really worthwhile myself. Do you want to, are there any outstanding things that we need to address, Jeff? Do you have any that you know?
Well, just to preface that a little bit, there were a lot of requests at the last meeting, so we printed off the same information that's been emailed out to you in hard copy for you to keep in your binders, so that can be distributed. We weren't able to get, there was a question around First Nations capacity to handle particular amounts of meat, and that there hasn't been any response to the emails and the phone calls that I put out for that. There's a few websites that are also down for additional information. So once that particular group in Conservation Area in Ontario, there's a request for that information.
I managed to get that before the website went down.
So that's available in hard copy, but the link was broken when I sent the email, so I didn't pass that along. So beyond that, this was an opportunity. I had a conversation with a few of you regarding some potential new items, and this was supposed to be an opportunity for those to be brought up to the attention of the rest of the members of the advisory group.
So could we move to table for next meeting those items? Okay.
So we'll flesh out everything that's been, all the work that's been completed here, and we'll put it in electronic format and send it out for email discussion before next week's meeting. If there's a little bit of time and desire, I wouldn't mind trimming up a date right now with people for next week, just so we have some advance notice as to when and how long. Mostly for me to see how long I have to get all this stuff done to you guys. So if there's a Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday that's preferable for anybody.
I'm just wondering, the every week, I would prefer every 2 weeks, just some breathing space in between and time to digest reading materials and ask some questions and formulate some thoughts.
We're getting a little bit into a time crunch, is the issue with taking 2 weeks off in between. And so we're into June, and in July at some point is when we're supposed to have a draft ready to go. And so I'm a little bit reticent to push to every 2 weeks.
So it's the date, not the process, that's important.
Both are important.
I wouldn't say there's that difference.
Well, I guess at the end of the day, we can always ask for more time if we need to.
Yeah.
Whether we'd be given it, it's not our decision.
Could we have a show of hands as to a Tuesday night or a Wednesday? Tuesday versus Wednesday? Is that really the main 2 days we're talking about? Okay, so Wednesday. How many would prefer Wednesdays?
I have no preference. I don't
know. So how many was that?
Doesn't matter to me, so I'll put my hand up.
So does that mean the Tuesday people would be amenable to coming Wednesday?
Yeah,
how many for Tuesday? Prefer Tuesday? One. Okay, so it looks like it's going to be Wednesday. Sorry, Carrie.
What about the people that aren't here?
Okay, well, I change.
That would be a family conflict.
Okay. So do we
Tuesday's fine and Thursday's fine.
Okay. Tuesday or Thursday? How's everybody for Thursday?
No.
Okay, let's see the Tuesdays. Okay, Tuesday the 12th. And the locale?
We'll try for back here, but that'll have to be determined based on the schedule.
You'll let us know. And the time?
Same
four,
time.
4 o'clock to 8 o'clock.
So we can watch the sunset.
That's right. Bring in some glasses. Okay, before I declare this closed, Orlando left me with this, and I'm giving it away. Who would like to have it? Okay, there we go.
Night takers.
Okay, and so at 8:04, I move that we adjourn.